everybody, and welcome back. In this video, we're going to be continuing talking about geocoding, but then we're going to be talking about what happens once the computer goes through that address standardization process. We're going to be comparing, or it's going to be comparing, that chopped up address to this reference layer, which is our highly specialized vector data set. And so it is a vector data set, and in order to do geocoding, your reference layer needs to depict the roads as lines. And so obviously, this needs to be accurate. You need to have a very accurate representation of all of the roads. Where all of the roads in your city, town, across the country, if you're trying to geocode across a country, are, because obviously if you don't have an accurate depiction of where all the roads are and where they actually go, your geocoding is not going to be able to be very accurate. That can be a lot of work to keep up. You know, if you're running a small town for a 911 operation, it's important to make sure all of that's accurate. If you're trying to keep an entire country or more accurate, you know, that's a very significant investment in resources to be able to update the geometry like that for accurate geocoding. But then not only do you have to have this very accurate geometry of all of the roads, but you also have to have very specialized attribute information. And you need this specialized attribute information for each one of these road segments. So this is one of those cases where you're probably going to, or you will, be breaking down the road into all of the different segments that are shown here, because you're going to need very specialized attribute information for every single segment of the roads. So here is the attribute table, and you're going to notice several similarities between this attribute table and the table, the address standardization table that the computer broke your addresses down into. They're not identical, but they are very similar because, of course, the computer is going to be able to use these for comparison. So we have prefix direction. We recognize that one. Prefix type. Notice that it's just left empty or null if there's no prefix type or prefix direction for that particular road or that particular segment of a road. Street name. Yes, of course, we need that. Street type. Yes, okay. Suffix direction, if there is one. Those line up with what was in our address standardization table. Notice that we do not have a number, obviously, because in the address we're looking for a particular number. This is recording information about the street. But we do have information about the numbers over here. I have from address and to address over here, and I've got numbers in each one of these. So this is telling me what street number or building number does this road segment start with. It goes from some number, and then at the end of this segment, it goes to some number. So from address and to address. So you can see not only do we have to have a very accurate geometry, but we also have to know a lot of attribute information about every single one of these road segments. Prefix direction, suffix type, street name, street type, suffix direction, and also exactly what building numbers are on each segment of road. And it all has to be entered in accurately, of course. So this is a lot of information to keep accurate. And so this is why people or companies who run geocoding services, such as Google Maps, Google has a very comprehensive geometry data set, vector data set, of, you know, roads all across the world. And of course they drive all of those the Google vans that are constantly keeping geometry updated and then all of the attribute information updated. That's what they do, and that's an extremely time and labor and money intensive task to keep this data set like this up. And that's why a data set like this does have commercial value, because people need to do geocoding, people want to do geocoding, but it requires a very comprehensive data set in order to be able to execute. So what happens next with this data set? So then we're going to get a comparison here between the address standardization table and then all of the information in the reference table. If you typed in 1215 or a 115 Oak Street or Oak Road, the computer would send that through the address standardization table, break it apart, say we've got a number of 115, we've got a street name of Oak, we've got a street type of road, and so whichever, here's in whichever little segment of a road, who knows, maybe it's that one right there, that this column on the attribute table, or this row on the attribute table represents, it would find something that is a match. It would say, okay, name Oak, street type, road, road, checks out. And then over here, this is 115 Oak Road. Look, this little section of Oak Road right here has 100 to 130, or contains house numbers, or runs from house numbers 100, or building numbers from 100 to 130. So it's going to identify this section right here as the location or potential location for 115 Oak Road. Okay, now it's going to drop a point where, we'll talk about that in a moment, but it would say at least that it's got a pretty good match here for 115 Oak Road going in there, and then it would give a rating depending on the different algorithms. It would give that rating of, like I said, typically between 0 to 100 about how sure it is that 115 Oak Road is somewhere on here, and it's going to drop its location on here. And in this case, it's probably a pretty high rating, and then would return that to you. And if the rating were high enough on your threshold for your particular project to drop that point down there, then it would do that. Now, when you're using Google Maps, you type in your address and it's extremely accurate. It drops it on there. Most every time you search for an address, it gets it right. But that's probably not going to be the case if you're trying to use your own data set for doing geocoding. You're going to set your threshold. For some cases, getting an okay match may be acceptable for your project. In other projects, you may have to have an extremely high quality of a match, just depending on your application. Okay, so then let's take a look at the next thing, which is how would the computer then know exactly where along this road that house or building number is? Well, it does this through interpolation, and it actually does this just through linear interpolation. This is linear interpolation. So if we're on Oak Road again, and let's say that we identified this line segment of Oak Road as running from 800 to 899, and we're trying to locate 850 Oak Road. Well, 850 is halfway between 800 and 899, so the computer would just come up with, well, what's the halfway distance? That's what linear interpolation is, assuming that everything, that there's an even amount of space between every number here. 150 Oak Road would drop right there. Likewise, if you're looking for 825 Oak Road, well, the computer's going to go, well, you know, this is 850. We need the exact same amount of space between 800 and 850. It's going to drop 825 Oak Road right there, halfway between 800 and 850. And that's it. There you go. That's geocoding. Now, many people, when they see this, they go, no, wait a minute. That's not what I'm expecting. That's identifying a location along this road with linear interpolation, but it's not doing several things that you might expect it to do, and you might be expecting it to do if you're used to using something like Google Maps. It's not, for instance, telling you which side of the street that number is on, right? Well, how can it do that? Well, as I just described this to you, it can't know. This is the best that it can do. All your geocoding operations here are estimates. That's as close as we can get using something called single range geocoding. This is single range geocoding. This was what I had the attribute table set up for. This is the data set that I had. And then when I do single range geocoding, this is what I get. If you want to be able to tell what side of the road the address should be on, you're going to need an even more sophisticated reference layer data set. So let's take a look at that. Here we have another example of an attribute table. So this attribute table would be connected to that line work for the reference layer. And notice here that I have increased information for the addresses. So here I don't just have from and to addresses, I actually have it specified in here that on the left we go from this number to this number, and on the right we go from this number to this number. This is called dual range geocoding, and this is what will allow you to make some allow the computer to make some kind of determination about whether or not that address is going to be on one side of the street or the other. So this is even more robust, an even more robust reference layer data set, not just from and to numbers, but we've got to make sure that we keep up to date exactly and find out exactly which numbers are on the left and exactly which numbers are on the right and enter them into the attribute table. Once I do that, I can start to make some kind of judgment about which side this would be on. Is this on the left or on the right? Well, if I have the left and right to and from addresses, then I should be able to make that judgment. And it would know, except for something that you still might not be expecting. You're like, okay, well, now it's on the left, or maybe this one's on the left and this one's on the right. It now knows which side, but it's still dropping the points right along the line. So it knows left or right, but now, come on, let's get this off of the street. Well, how do you do that? The computer doesn't have any way of knowing how far that position is supposed to be off of the street. It doesn't know where the actual house is. It now just knows left or right. So we have to come up with some other way to make an estimation about where that building or where that house is. And we do that with something called the offset distance. So here in this example, you can see that we've moved the dots, the placement of the points for the addresses, off of the street. So if this one is on this side, this one is on this side. But we've done this because we've set something called the offset distance. And so when you're setting up your geocoding service, you might say, I would like an offset distance of 30 feet. So yeah, don't put the point itself right on the line or the line of the road. Let's back it off by some standardized offset distance, which is going to be appropriate for the area that you're doing geocoding for. Then you get this visual depiction of a point being on the left or on the right side of the road as you go along. Well, now you might be thinking, that's not what I want. You know, I want, if this is the house right here, I want I want the geocoding service to come by and drop that directly on the house. Well, again, that's just not something that it's going to be able to do without even further sophistication of data sets and so forth. Because certainly this is an estimation. It's probably not the case that everybody's house or every building on the street is equally far away from the road. Some may be closer, some may be further away. But how would we know that? You know, the computer wouldn't know that when you set up a geocoding service. In order to really know, I mean, you can augment, if you're really interested in this, you can, and you have to have this for your particular analysis, you can start to augment your geocoding data. Maybe you get the point right here. And then depending on how many you have, if you just have a limited number of points that you've geocoded anyway, sometimes people will augment this with imagery. And so they'll drop in imagery for behind their data layer and then start individually moving points, individually moving the layers. Oh, if this is, 875 Oak Road, and then they look at the imagery or the aerial photography, and they see the house or building right there, well, then they'll just take it and move it manually to that point so that it's over the house. If, A, you have enough time because your data set is small enough, and if it even matters for the purposes of your analysis. We're kind of spoiled by the fact that Google Maps, we type in an address and it drops it right down on top of the building. We're spoiled by that. You don't get all of that when you set up a geocoding service inside a general GIS. They're doing a lot more sophisticated things. And in fact, I think in order to find this offset distance, when the Google Maps van is driving around, so we got the van here. Here's the Google van driving down the road. So it's updating the geometry and also making sure all the attribute information is correct for this section of Oak Road. As it's driving by, if it sees a house over here, I think that it takes a laser rangefinder and hits your front door with the laser beam. And so it can find out exactly how far back from the road a particular house is. So I think that's what it does. Somebody told me that at one point. And so that's how they are getting the offset distance. But that's some pretty sophisticated stuff, very time consuming, and takes a lot of resources. So I am also kind of with geocoding trying to temper your expectations. The Google Maps is very robust. But that's because it's extremely specialized. It does what it does very well, this geocoding very well. But then you have to understand why it does that very well. And that's because it has a lot more data than just standard geocoding services. Let's also take a look at something else that would be a problem for your geocoding. One of the problems with the interpolation, and you probably saw this in the beginning, so if we're looking at this section of Oak Road, and we know that it goes from some number over here to some number over here on both the left and the right, the assumption is that all of the land parcels are the exact same size and that everything is equally distributed. Maybe these are all the houses along Oak Road, and they're all at the offset distance, and they're all equally spaced all across this road segment. And again, geocoding locations are estimates. This is probably not the case. It may not be the case at all, and especially in rural areas where you have can have great variety in both the size of the lots and then also where the houses are. So, I mean, it could be the case that on this side of the road, you know, there's this, the first lot, you know, is really big. It's like this. And then over here, we've got a lot. And then over here, one, two, three, four. Maybe this one is pretty large as well. And then this one is much smaller. And then when you take a look at where the houses are, you know, maybe this house over here is way back here, and this house is way up here in the front, and this house is here, and this house is, in the back of its lot. So, again, tempering your expectations, you're only going to get an estimation here. You're not going to be able to identify the exact location of the house using methods which are going to be typically available to you, especially if you set up your own service. And also, when you do this, it's not going to have any idea when it returns that quality of match, that value about how high quality the computer thinks that the match is. You know, if it's going to say, hey, I put the dot right here, and I think that's an extremely high quality match, but that doesn't have anything to do, again, with the actual location of the house. We may have another one right here, and it says that's a very high-quality match, but because of the size of the lots in actuality, and then also the placement of the houses, you know, it could be in the incorrect location. But to the computer, that would still be a very high-quality match, potentially. Well, okay, I mean, I suppose that is geocoding in theory. There is a whole lot to it. the quality of the results that you're going to get geocoding have to do with the quality of the addresses that you're inputting, your ability to standardize them, or the computer's ability to standardize them, and then the computer's or the accuracy and reliability of the reference layer in all locations across it, plus whatever auxiliary information or extra time you're willing to put in to make sure that the points get where they're supposed to be if they're not placed as accurately as you would like for them to be. Typically, you know, when you're doing this inside a GIS and you're trying to, you're not trying to just digitize one address, you're trying to locate 500 or 1,000 or 10,000 addresses. That's why we don't just use Google Maps for that, because that's just a one at a time thing. In GIS, when people are doing geocoding, they may have tens of thousands of addresses. Maybe a company has the address of every single one of its customers. And so it wants a map showing where all of the customers live. That's geocoding tens of thousands, potentially, or hundreds or thousands of different addresses. So Google Maps is not the right tool for that. You have to go to a dedicated geocoding service inside a GIS platform that will let you run 1,000, 2,000, 5,000 addresses potentially and get you that point vector file back where it has been able to place all of them. And it would give you a report as well on what the quality of match score for every single one of those 10,000 addresses is. And that allows you to say, hey, accept all of the ones that are 80 and above. And then maybe, you know, if the number of matches in your so-so range is small enough, you know, you can go back and manually review every one. Well, you could manually review every match the computer made and determine for yourself whether or not it is actually correct or whether it's not correct, and try to improve the data set that way. I rather frequently have people ask me what they need to do if they have a few thousand addresses for a research project that they need to geocode. And there are ways to get those geocoded and different services to use. But we're not going to go over that in this video. We'll just stick with the theory here. Okay, so I suppose that is geocoding in theory. So, hope you learned something.